Well, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Following on the steps of Mrs. Amos, I would like to inform you that the meeting of the Security Council of today has been, relatively speaking, more moderate than previous meetings of the Security Council. The reason for this moderation is mainly speaking attributed to the Syrian government's measures taken recently with regard to facilitating the humanitarian assistance of the United Nations as well as the of the international non-governmental organizations with regard to the distribution of humanitarian assistance inside Syria. These measures were expressed and notified, officially speaking, to the Secretary General as well as to the members of the Security Council in an official letter I sent on behalf of my government on November the 25th. In this letter, we notified everybody that the Syrian government allows OCHA as well as the international organizations working in the field of humanitarian assistance inside Syria to use the official crossing borders, of Syria with the neighboring countries to transit through this official crossing border the humanitarian assistance, except the northern part of Syria, meaning our borders with Turkey, for the reasons that were elaborated by Mrs. Amos. I guess you are all aware of the content of our letter. If not, it's being circulated in the six official languages, and it's available for all of you. However, briefly speaking, the Syrian government decided to allow the crossing of humanitarian assistance through our border with Iraq in an area called Ya'rubiya, which means that right now OCHA and international organizations in close cooperation with the Syrian government could transit the humanitarian assistance through Lebanon, Jordan, and Iraq. Additionally to that, we have also decided to create three additional recruitmental hubs in Sweda for the southern region of Syria, the border of Syria with Jordan, in Qamishli, in the northern part, eastern northern part, and of course we had three other hubs before in Tartus, in Homs, and Damascus. So now we have six main hubs in Syria for the distribution of humanitarian assistance. So I said Sweda, Aleppo, and Qamishli. Sweda for the south, Aleppo for the north, Qamishli for the eastern, eastern part of Syria. Plus Tartus, Homs, and Damascus, that makes six hubs. We have doubled the number of hubs from three to six. As with regard the issuance of visas, we have issued only this year, for the last 11 months, 222 visas. Recently, in the last 10 days, we have also issued an additional 50 new visas. So the pending visas are only maybe 10 or less. In 2013, we have deployed 37 joint convoys for the distribution of humanitarian assistance. Joint convoys, meaning convoys organized by both OCHA and the international organizations, as well as by the Syrian government. These 37 joint convoys are independent from the overall numbers of convoys. I would like to underline a very important fact. So far, and in spite of all the thankful efforts done by the United Nations with regard to the distribution of humanitarian assistance inside Syria, only 25% of the needs were covered by the UN. Only 25% of the humanitarian needs were covered by the United Nations. The remaining 75% were covered by the Syrian government itself, without any help from anybody, in spite of the so-called coercive unilateral measures that they call sanctions imposed on the Syrian government. Till now, the Syrian government assumes the responsibility of covering 75% of the overall assessment of humanitarian needs. These are maybe the main points. Of course, we will have to also underline a very important element, which is that the problem in Syria is not exclusively a humanitarian crisis. The crisis in Syria is rather a political one. It requires the cooperation of all the countries and governments involved in instigating violence and terrorism inside Syria. Here, I would like to focus, mainly speaking, on the very negative role played by Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Turkey, who are working tirelessly to prevent the convening of Geneva II conference, because these governments don't believe in the political settlement of the Syrian crisis. They are seeking regime change by the use of force and by through terrorism. In this week, ladies and gentlemen, thousands of Saudi fighters were killed in Syria. Thousands. 300 Saudis are taken prisoners by the Syrian army. We have now 300 Saudi citizens taken prisoners, plus thousands of Saudis were killed. Somebody should keep these Saudis and hold them responsible for what they are doing. Qatar, of course, is sponsoring also the Islamist groups. All of them, of course, are against the convening of Geneva Conference and are linked to Al-Qaeda and the Al-Nusra Front and Daesh, the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. This is how they call themselves. But they are all, of course, ramifications and offshoot of Al-Qaeda. Turkey is facilitating the logistical moves through our border with Turkey. Israel is treating the wounded guys, of course, in the Israeli hospitals. So it's a big mafia. It's a very big mafia. And nobody is holding anybody responsible for what they are taking. For all these terrorist activities, in spite of the fact that these Security Council resolutions related to combating terrorism prevent member states from sponsoring, training, helping, covering the activities of the terrorist organizations, including, of course, Al-Qaeda. So here we have a rather a very serious dimension of the Syrian crisis, which is the political